wish you all were standing up when she does that, so that somebody besides me can kick up their heel. All right, good morning.
Good morning.
I am delighted that you are here. There are a number of things I need to say. So, huge thanks to all of you. Wave your hands in the air if you came to trunk or treat yesterday. Mm-hmm. One is fine, I know you're tired. We had a weird small little crowd, but you know what? I had a really good conversation with a grandma who had brought these two young girls who apparently came last year on their way to their church's fall festival, except that they ended up spending 2 to 3 hours here because they were having so much fun. And today they were like, can we go to the church? And here they were. So I'm beginning to think that we are not specializing in large extravaganzas, but rather bespoke fellowship and community opportunities. And that is a thing that our world needs. So thank you to all of you who helped make that happen. This Friday, you should come to Bailey Hall and bring some food with you because we're going to talk about death. And you would definitely not want to miss that. Okay, that took a minute. All right, we really are going to talk about death. It's gonna be great. Quote from a previous book group where we spent like 13 weeks reading a book about death. At some point somebody said, who knew it would be so much fun to talk about death? Y'all, it's gonna be good. You should come. I will clarify, we are gonna talk more about death than we are about grief, if that helps you prepare your heart to be ready for this conversation. So I hope that you will join us. The reason we're doing that is that Friday is All Saints Day, and next Sunday we will be having our All Saints Memorial Service when we will remember those who have left us in the last year, but also all of those that we are missing, all the things that do bring us grief and sorrow. It is highly probable that there is someone in your life who does not go to church here, who would be blessed by you inviting them to worship next Sunday. Think for a second about who that person in your life might be. And tomorrow I want you to pray a little prayer and ask God to give you the courage, the oomph, the grace that you need to extend that invitation, okay? This is important. So, all right, that is all about next weekend. There are a couple other things in here you can read, but the other important thing that you need to know about this weekend is that Friday is Norma Bailey's birthday.
Woo-hoo!
Do you want to stand up?
Sure.
Okay. Do you want to do a dance? It's entirely up to you. You may interpret this song however you choose. So let's sing her song.
All right.
Happy birthday to you.
Thank you.
your bulletin or the screens to prepare yourself to join in our responsive call to worship.
And when you prepare yourself, sometimes you get it all mixed up. You ever been like me? I got up this morning and I was wondering why Karen was drinking tea, watching television at 5:30 in the morning, because usually she wakes up to leave at 5:30 to work or whatever. I didn't understand that. I went back to sleep or whatever. And then eventually I was awake, and I guess as she's walking around the house or whatever, she's got screwdrivers and she's taking the stuff that we had used yesterday where?
At Trunk or Treat.
Right here at Trunk or Treat. Can we spend the whole day here? Yeah, yes. Okay. Seems like you spend the whole night putting everything away and then last night. Oh yeah. And so she was using that stuff now apparently to decorate our front of the house. I'm thinking, what in the world? Because I'm thinking, I've been at church. This is Monday morning. How come she's not going to work? How come she keeps hanging around? Is it ever like that for you? You are so involved in what's going on, and we've spent so much time at things like Trunk or Treat or whatever it was. I thought we had moved on. We'd already been at church. Sometimes it's like that. You just forget because you're caught up in things and you're just moving on, and there's a lot of buzz and joy. I had dressed up for Halloween since when I was a child. I thought of Halloween as a cold season holiday, but I didn't like that anymore. It's always hot, so I made sure not to wear much. So I decorated my truck in surfboards, and then I wore a bunch of surf stuff, including this thing. And I brought this thing from one of the Ed and Anita Gerling, you know, 60th wedding anniversaries or something from somebody here. Do you ever have stuff around the house that you decorate things with? Because the decorations that you're making really are, they're not just to face the street and say, hey, the holiday is for you. They really are about who you are. They're about turning inward and saying, here's what the holiday is that includes you and includes the people that you spent that time with. And I tell you what, do we have Zoom people out there, Karen?
We do.
Is my mom on there?
Your mom is on there.
Oh my goodness gracious. Glenda, if you're there, you know, Eileen Kaiser washes up real nice, but this was...
The camera's there.
Yeah, you cannot believe how horrible looking we can become for Halloween. And the things that we do just to, I don't know, put on a good face to the community, and yet you end up feeding yourself, right?
Right.
Did you get caught up? Did you think it was Monday too?
Nope.
We did church yesterday, even if you didn't know it was church. Now we're gathering together again. This is my second church this weekend. So I'm going to be one and you be all in our responsive call to worship. Good morning, and I'm going to change that. Good Sunday morning, friends. We gather once again, just like yesterday. And in the same way that parking lot's a holy place, we're inside here in this holy place, where our hearts are revived and our souls are restored.
We come to find rest in the mercy and compassion of God, to reconnect with Jesus and the whole body of Christ.
We come with spirits that are weary and worried. The times we find ourselves in are difficult and divided. The future is uncertain.
We come to renew our hope and remind ourselves of the deepest convictions of our faith, that love is stronger than death, that truth matters, that mercy has power.
When we live in Christ, we can be grounded in joy, even when life is full of tension and fear. When we live in Christ, we can give thanks in all circumstances, for the world is in God's hands.
Let us worship with joy and humble thanksgiving.
And would you bow briefly with me? Dear Lord, we are now into such a potentially uncertain time, and yet into such a meaningful time of year, filled with holidays of great joy and of great meaning. The Halloween that we experienced in our parking lot, and that we aim at children. The Thanksgiving that we sang about this morning already, aimed at family and at food and at thankfulness, and that we might even imagine expanding our family with. And the Christmas time aimed at all of these things as we face off the shortness of winter days. It's like one long Sunday in my mind. And on Sundays here in worship, we re-find the rejuvenation that life in Jesus Christ can bring. For Jesus Christ, you are the light of the world. Fill our minds with your peace and our hearts with your love. In his name we pray, and pray for this anthem of the choir. Elijah Rock's going to take it out of you. Amen.
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 It does need a special blessing.
Shout, shout, Elijah Rock coming up, Lord, Elijah Rock. Shout, shout, Elijah Rock coming up, Lord, Elijah Rock. Shout, shout, Elijah Rock coming up, Lord, Elijah Rock. Shout, shout, Elijah Rock coming up, Lord. Elijah Rock, shout, shout, Elijah Rock coming up, Lord. Satan's a liar and a conjurer too. If you don't watch out, he'll conjure you. If I could, I surely would stand on the rock where Moses stood. Elijah Rock.
Shout, shout, Elijah Rock, coming up, Lord, Elijah Rock. Shout, shout, Elijah Rock, coming up, Lord, Elijah Rock, Elijah Rock, Elijah, Elijah Rock, Elijah Rock, Elijah, Elijah Rock, Elijah Rock, Elijah, Elijah Rock, Elijah Rock, Elijah. Elijah Rock, shout, Elijah Rock, coming up, Lord, Elijah Rock, shout, Elijah Rock, coming up, Lord.
Good morning.
Who do we have on Zoom?
We have Betty.
Betty.
Kathy. Glenda.
Glenda.
And Daniel.
Good morning, Zoomers.
Good morning.
God loves you, Zoomers.
God loves you, Zoomers. All right, so let us turn to a time of prayer as we share the joys and concerns of this community and beyond. While we were here having a big old party, a baby got born. Some of us forgot this baby was even coming because certain people have been very quiet about it. But if you look back there, you can see John and Jennifer Layton, who are jumping up and down because baby Ryan Coe Layton, who was 7 pounds and 12 ounces, arrived yesterday about 3 o'clock to Jamie and Jeff Layton. Are they still in the hospital? Adjusting to breathing air and things like that, but all is well. So we are so excited, and we join with him with that grin. All right. God, with joyful hearts,
we give you thanks.
I do want to give thanks again just one more time for the lovely trick-or-treat and all of our wonderful volunteers and the impact that we do have on the folks who come here, who have come here year after year and know that this is a safe and friendly, fun place for them to be with their kids. God, with joyful hearts,
we give you thanks.
We are continuing to pray with Jennifer. She's been to PT twice this week. And what? Which finger? Is still a pinky finger that moves a little?
All of them.
All of them move a little bit more. So this is good. We continue to pray for improvement. She's going to see the orthopedist again and a neurologist. So let's give thanks for that progress. God, with joyful hearts,
we give you thanks.
But continue in prayer for Jennifer's recovery from whatever it is that happened to that arm. Be careful of the kitchen floor. It's slippery. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
I'm going to drink some more water. We are so glad. Okay, I take it back. We were so glad to have Mary Jane Fay with us yesterday and earlier today. She is pretty worn out, I think, from yesterday, but we give thanks that her atrial fibrillation on Monday went well. The aftermath was a little bad at the places where the little things got stuck on, either from an allergic reaction to the adhesive or possibly just because there was a lot of electricity there. So she had a very unpleasant night Monday, but she is doing better, and we'll see the doctor again in like December. So prayers that all went relatively smoothly. God, with joyful hearts,
we give you thanks.
Becky Neely was scheduled to have her nerve ablation on her knees done on Friday, but all I have heard is that it was postponed for now. Does anybody else have any more detail on that? That is literally all I know. I don't know the whys or the wherefores or any new scheduling. So continue prayers for Becky as she deals with pain. She had a fall, but I don't know if that is what caused this to be postponed. But continue prayers for Becky and Bob. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Continue prayers for Sandy Hannah's mother-in-law, Brenda, up north. She has moved back to a rehab now, so we are hoping she gets to stay there this time, no more falls, and that she'll be able to regain her strength, and that they will be able to continue fighting the terrible infection she's been struggling with. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
We give thanks with Matt Epler, who moved home from rehab this week after his knee replacement surgery. He's doing well and walking without a walker, which I believe was the goal. So, God, with joyful hearts,
we give you thanks.
We are continuing to pray with Betty Sullivan as she continues mostly to recover, but also to deal with some of her gastro issues. She has also asked today for prayers for her daughter, Cheryl, who is continuing to deal with pain and now has some new medications and procedures that she's going to be adjusting to. So prayers for Cheryl as well. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Continue to pray always for Brenda Rory Beatty. We know she is going through particularly rough, bad time right now. If you can go see Brenda, that would be really helpful. Brenda is a highly social animal, and she does better when she sees her friends. I know many of you have tried to reach out to her on her phone. That doesn't work when she's in this way. She may see them. She's not going to write you back. We're not going to know. But if you can get yourself there, even for just a brief visit, it will be very helpful. If you need to know where it is, come see Mary Perrin after church. But continue prayers for Brenda. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
And continue prayers for Nora Lee and Dick Penny, who, as you know, are struggling with a lot. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
I want to lift up all of those impacted by Tropical Storm Trami in the Philippines, which you may have heard about. Over 100 people are dead or missing, presumed dead. So prayers for that. It's been a terrible situation, and they seem to think there is some chance that that storm is literally going to make a U-turn and come back, which would obviously be really, really bad and somewhat rare. So we pray for those folks, and of course all of those here in the States and around the world who are struggling with the aftermath of hurricanes and floods and fires and all sorts of disasters. I will direct you always to www.weekofcompassion.org. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
We continue to pray for the war and the humanitarian crisis in Gaza and the West Bank, in Israel, and for the escalation of aggression in Lebanon, Syria, Iran, Yemen, and other places. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
lift up so many other places as well that are dealing with conflict and violence. Ukraine, Sudan, where 14 million people are displaced by the civil war. That's an unbelievable number. Congo, Haiti, Venezuela, Ethiopia, South China Sea, so many places that are living in turmoil and violence. We pray for peace. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Our Global Ministries prayer partner this week is Japan, where the Asian Rural Institute is one of our mission partners. Our Pacific Southwest Regional Prayer Partner, you could literally drive by and cheer for them. It is University Christian Church here in San Diego this week, where Caleb Lines and Marcella Salgado Solorio serve as pastors. We pray for these and all our partners in ministry. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
What else can we lift up? Nothing on Zoom yet. Does anybody else have joys or concerns we can share today? Somebody say something, because I need to take a second to clear my throat.
Here, Jenny. So two things. Trunk or treat, I know I was really anxious about it because I didn't know if we would have enough help to really make it run. And I want to really thank Rebecca, because Rebecca reached out to people beyond our congregation who came and had cars and helped with things and I think had a good time. Yeah, and certainly the families that came had a wonderful time. So thank you, Rebecca, for all your hard work in organizing that. God, with joyful hearts, we give you thanks. And I know Rebecca already lifted up Brenda, but I will tell you, I went and saw her yesterday, and she probably had not eaten anything for a couple of days at least, and not much all week. She was very out of it. I was able to get her some Glucerna, and by the time I left, she was somewhat more with it. But her phone had died, and she had not had enough care or energy or desire to get it plugged in and charged again. And that's why she didn't answer any texts all week, because her phone wasn't charged, and she just was so out of it and just depressed, I think, that she didn't even care to plug in her phone and get it charged. So it's really a desperate situation. When I saw her yesterday, when I got there, I thought, okay, we're back to looking at the end. She needs to want to live. She needs to want to eat, and I think it's visits from people that help make that happen. So. Yeah, lift her up.
Yeah. And I will say, if you want to stop at Fraser Farms and pick up a piece of tiramisu, she might eat that, because I fed her that back in June when she was almost just a couple days before she went to the hospital. So yes, this is...
it's desperate.
This is a desperate situation. Obviously, we cannot make those choices for other people, but we can be the body of Christ and surround those who are in need. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Is there anything else? We're all really tired.
Yes.
It's a good day. It wasn't nearly as hot as it might have been. Yeah. Anything could have been hotter. Let us continue in prayer. Holy and gracious God, we come to you as your people, as your children, as followers of your Christ. We come asking that you will enfold us in your arms, hold us in your heart, encircle us with your compassion. We come, O God, weary and worn out, worried and stressed about our own lives and about our shared life. We come to you this day asking your blessing, asking your hope, asking your revival, O God. We come because where else do we have to go? You have the words of life, O God. And so we come to you and we offer up all the contents of our hearts, all the cares, all the concerns, all the worries, all the sorrows, all the joy and thanksgiving and generosity. We come this day trusting that you are already holding all those whose names we have lifted up, all those who are cradled silently in our hearts, all those we don't even know, O God, those who cry out in the depths of their beings, in fear or hunger or despair. We come to you trusting, O God, that it is all in your hands.
We come to you this morning giving thanks for so many blessings, for the capacity you have given to each of us to come together to work with one another to bring joy and life and mercy and love into one another's lives, into the lives of those around us, into the lives of people we will never even meet, oh God. We come to you giving thanks for the blessing of this church, for the blessing of the ministry you call us to here in this place, for the witness we bear here to your light and your hope and your love. We pray for those who are preparing even now to join with us in this community of faith. We pray that you would teach us to reach them, to welcome them, to help them find their place at your table of love, oh God. We pray this day for our community, for our elderly, for our children, for those living rough, for those who are working so hard to help others flourish, for our healthcare workers and our teachers, for our leaders, oh God. We pray that you might shape their hearts with wisdom and humility, with grace and creativity and compassion. We pray, oh God, that you would teach us to look beyond labels, that you would teach us to look beyond our prejudices, our stereotypes, that you would teach us to see one another as brothers and sisters and siblings. We pray, O God, for your future, that we might be faithful in all that we do. We pray this day for all those struggling to put their lives back together after storms, hurricanes, and flooding and fires. We pray, O God, for your hope and your help. We give you thanks for all those who have turned their hearts and their minds, their hands and their feet to rebuilding in places where devastation seemed to reign. We pray this day for those struggling to survive in the midst of violence and war, for those struggling through famine. We pray that you would turn the hearts of those who would make war to your peace, to your wisdom, to your justice, O God. We pray this day for peace. We pray for peace. We pray for your peace. We pray this day for the healing of all creation. We pray that we might be your people, redeemed and revealed as your light. We pray it all in Jesus' holy name. Amen. As Cheryl comes up, I'm going to invite you. I'm going to pull a Jerry Bailey and invite you to go ahead and get your Bibles out, because you're going to need them longer than you think you are.
Our first reading today is from the letter to the church in Philippi, chapter 4, verses 4 through 8. And since you now are getting them, you can find it on page 198 in the New Testament section of the Red Bibles in the chair racks, if you'd like to follow along. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. May the Holy Spirit add blessing to this reading from the epistle.
And if you turn then just a couple pages, you can find our second reading from the letter to the church in Colossae, chapter 3, verses 12 through 17. Don't read much beyond that, it won't make you happy. But chapter 3, verses 12 through 17. As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other. Just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in the one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another in all wisdom. And with gratitude in your hearts, sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. May the Holy Spirit add blessing to this reading from this week. Will you pray with me and for me as we move into the word together? Don't put your Bibles away yet, though. Holy God, bless the speaking and the hearing of these words, that we might hold fast to the heart of Christ and live with full compassion for all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This sermon is going to feel more like Bible study than sermon for a bit here, because there are some more words we need to read. If you haven't gotten your Bible out yet, please go ahead and do so now. Those two readings we just heard sounded very similar, didn't they? Had a similar tone. They are both what scholars call exhortations, the parts of Paul's letters and the other epistles devoted to teaching the guiding values with which Christians should carry themselves. They are mostly, as you may have noticed, relational, aimed at reminding us how to behave toward one another and other people in general. So before we dig in deeper, let's read a couple more. If you turn to page 205, we can read out of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Just a little snippet here, verses 15 through 22 of chapter 5 in 1 Thessalonians. This is going to sound very familiar, Cheryl. Rejoice always! Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the spirit. Do not despise the words of prophets, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. And then let's flip back. All the way back to page 162, a longer section that will again sound familiar, from Romans 12. On page 162, I'm going to read verses 9 through 21. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of if it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them.
If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. That's a quote from Proverbs, so it's probably meant to be ironic a little bit. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. All right, keep them out, because now there's a test. All right, that was four variations on similar ideas. Let's sit with them a minute. You can look at whichever page, page 198, page 201, page 205, 162. What are the words or ideas that have stuck with you? Say some words you just heard a lot, maybe more than once.
Patience.
Rejoice in hope.
Rejoice and hope. What else did you hear? What stuck with you?
Forgive.
Love and bless.
Kindness.
Is there any exhortation in there that seems particularly difficult?
Love those who persecute you.
Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Anything else that seems difficult?
Do not judge.
Yes. All right.
Do not take revenge.
What does it say? Never avenge yourselves. Yes. So there was one in what Cheryl read that the juxtaposition of the two sentences. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. As one of my struggles. Anything else that seems hard? Is there a memory verse in there that you would like to grab hold of from any of these passages? Something you would like to carry with you as you go about your week?
Pray without ceasing.
Extend hospitality to strangers.
In so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all.
Which I think is kind of where you were going there as well, right, Mariana?
Yeah.
Living in harmony.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
For me, whenever we get into these, it's always the one that was set to music, right? Rejoice in the Lord always again, I say rejoice. We should probably have songs for the rest of it, though, right? So, what's interesting to me about these passages is how the history we are living in is shifting my perspective on them. In previous times, they seemed to me like fairly generic good ideas, almost bland moralizing that people mostly nodded along to, but didn't necessarily listen to all that carefully. They seemed like universals, right? Things that were true and good 2,000 years ago that still serve as worthy guidelines for us today. They are a point of connection between us and the earliest Christians, because they are such broad principles. And those connections are important, right? Because most of the time, in order to read scripture responsibly, we need to keep in mind how very different our lives are from those of first century Christians, or any of the other people living so long ago, Christian or not. It's almost impossible, I think, for us to imagine what it was like to live under Roman occupation in a time with only rudimentary technologies, when social structures were so much more rigid and determinative. How can we even begin to understand what it meant, what it felt like to be a Christian, when confessing Christ could mean imprisonment, torture, or even execution? For most of my life, it has seemed as though the stresses of the early Christians and the way they handled them probably weren't that relevant to my daily experiences. And let me be clear, I do not think any of us are headed for execution. This is not a sermon about Christians being persecuted. Yes? We all understand that, okay? It's important. But I do not think it would be inaccurate to say that life has gotten more complicated in the past few years. Division is high, anxiety is soaring, the stakes of our big decisions are higher than we've been accustomed to. In many ways, it feels as though our society, nationally and globally, is teetering on the edge of something. Destruction, revolution, certainly something difficult, possibly something ugly, potentially something violent. It's not the same situation as the early Christians. The stresses of their lives are starting to seem more relatable. The New York Times is reporting today on a new poll that shows that 3/4 of Americans say that democracy is under threat. It's not clear from that single statistic if they all believe the threat is coming from the same source or not, but clearly we are worried. I have friends on social media, smart, engaged, capable people who are sharing with one another that their high levels of anxiety are making them struggle just to carry on their lives. Their worries about the election, the nation, their neighbors, the world are overwhelming. People are worried about the election. They're worried about what will happen after the election. It is new in the United States for us to have to concern ourselves with whether we will have a peaceful transfer of power or not. That is not something we've had to worry about until recently. Now here, in a decidedly not swing state, it's possible the effects of all of this are a bit muted. But we know that there are plenty of people right here in East County who could easily be compelled toward violence if things don't turn out the way they want. So what is a Christian to do in a world that has become so scary? First of all, we can do what we're doing right now. We can lay out our fears together here in the light of God, asking for solace and wisdom. Fears we refuse to face are fears that can sneak up from behind and capture our hearts while our minds remain unaware. Next thing we know, we're behaving in ways that are reactions to our anxieties rather than expressions of our deepest convictions. A few weeks ago, we gathered for our first supper of substance to consider and discuss our concerns about the upcoming election. One of the questions we pondered was this. Imagine that the worst happens and the things you're most worried about regarding the upcoming election come true. Which faith convictions or guiding values would you turn to most? How would your faith and your values inspire you to respond to what comes next? This is where we come back to our scripture readings. Because what are these exhortations but passionate reminders of the ideals we aim to live by? Compassion, forgiveness, thanksgiving, peace, solidarity, mutuality, kindness, humility, patience, hospitality, joy, honor, truth, love. 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 We may not be able to fix our world with our votes or even our activism, but we can always, always continue to choose love. We can commit ourselves to choosing kindness and honesty and grace no matter how bad things get. Once we start to recognize how important it is to ground ourselves in our highest convictions, even and especially in difficult times like these, we can see how important these exhortations were for the Christians in Philippi and Colossae and Thessalonica and Rome. These are not mere generic moralizing, they are exhortations. In times of difficulty, there is no more important message for us to share with one another than encouragement to remember to be people of love, people of grace, gratitude, and humility, that is, followers of Jesus. Historian Heather Cox Richardson, in her letter to an American yesterday, was quoting extensively from a war talk pamphlet that was sent to members of the military during World War II. This one was aimed at helping the troops understand the dangers and operations of fascism. One line in particular stuck out to me. The propaganda of fascism, it said, insists that it is smart and realistic to be pitiless and violent. No, 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 no. As Christians, that is the sort of thing we must stand up and say no to. It is neither smart nor realistic, nor patriotic, nor appropriate, nor decent, nor neighborly, and most definitely not Christian to be either pitiless or violent. Let us exhort one another to remember that our calling is love. Our calling is kindness and mercy and peace and truth, so far as it depends on you. Live peaceably with all. All we can do is what depends on us. We cannot magically call into being the world we desire. All we can do is carry ourselves within the world we have in the manner of Christ Jesus. What are those deepest values that you will turn to if your worst fears come true? Where will they take you? We've grown accustomed to a world where there were norms and mores that held society's most violent impulses in check. That is not the world we live in anymore, which is hard to accept. How will we respond to our new reality? Faithfully, I hope. Compassionately. Courageously. Honestly, the very fact that these letters full of exhortation have come down to us over the centuries is testament to the fact that humanity has been through times of upheaval and uncertainty, violence and chaos before. Can we find comfort in reminding one another that at some level, in whatever way each of us makes sense of it, we are people who believe the world is in God's hands. We practice hope even when we find it difficult to believe in wholeheartedly. Now we may know that saying everything is in God's hands doesn't mean that bad things won't happen. God, as we have seen, is much less impressed by the power of death than we are, and not nearly as attached to security. And yet we can continue to choose love. We can continue to choose mercy and kindness and humility. And even if hope is hard to see, for me, each time we choose love, each time we are brave enough to stand up and speak out for mercy and compassion and generosity of spirit, each of those moments is a testimony to the goodness and presence of God. Let us exhort one another. Let us comfort one another. Let us join together and bear witness to the goodness of God. to the compassion of Christ, and to the power of the Holy Spirit to bind us together across all divisions. Let us understand deep in our souls that empty platitudes will not meet this moment. Rather, let us call one another soul to soul to truly live the gospel, holding fast to the good news of mercy and justice and love and peace with joy and humble thanksgiving. No matter what comes, let us follow Jesus. Hallelujah. Our hymn of response this morning is number 568. Doesn't say so there, but we will sing it through all the way twice. It is at this time that we invite forward anyone who wishes to join with this congregation by confession of faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, or by transfer of membership from another congregation. It is at this time that we are all invited to rededicate our hearts and our lives to the ministry of Jesus Christ. Will you stand with me as you are able and sing?
I thought of two people I could ask that I've never asked before. So in this message to giving, it's not just about money. Yes, it is our offering, but it's also we have something to offer to people. We're not begging for people to come to worship because we'll die if we don't. We're offering a place where people can worship and they might die if they don't experience this. So we have not too much to risk by inviting, because we're entering that season where people long to be in worship, even if they're not sure they can find a church they can trust enough. Invite them. Invite somebody. Two women heard me talking about my quilting, and I haven't known them very well. They live right down the hall from me, but I'd already suggested coming to church here, and the one woman said that I really respect, you know, I just do church on Zoom now. I keep my membership at Riverside Church in New York City. And I said, I'm humbled to actually meet somebody who's a member there. But they've asked me to finish two quilts for them. And I'm gonna ask them to come here and worship. Worship where you find people that say, I'd be glad to finish your quilt for you. I'm not blackmailing them. I want them to have a place to keep their membership where they're true, but to come here for fellowship.
Yes.
And to witness that we get to be ourselves and grow in faith. And so let us be those who can find in worship or at the kitchen sink or out in the garden somebody that might need to be here for All Saints Day, Thanksgiving season, Christmas blessings, the new year. Yes, there's going to be an election, but we have a rock to stand on. And this time is not a war between conservative and liberal. God made us so that we work together for strength and listen to each other with compassion and honor. And this is a place where we can have honest discussions and grow and love one another. Let us receive our offerings.
Amen.
Amen.
Future tithes and offerings are located in our hearts and minds. For our future is always partly in our hearts and minds. The future, though, is not something that resides solely within ourselves, because much is beyond our desires, beyond our aspirations, beyond our hearts and minds. And that brings us back into these plates. For it's in the here and now that we give as we can to pay forward to the future that which we value from our past and put into our now. Help us to be better stewards of what we have now. In His name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. We come to this table. I'm bummed that is Mary Jane on Zoom?
No.
Did she go home and get us? She was really worn out, y'all. But I know that she remembers this. I don't know if any of the rest of you remember this, but a long, long time ago, we did a thing, I think it came from Disciples Home Missions, where we learned about holy manners. Does anybody remember that phrase, holy manners? Yes. I was trying to figure out how all of those exhortation passages connect to the table, and that is it, my friend. come to this table to learn and practice holy manners. Not every time we do this, not in every church where the Lord's Supper is celebrated, does this happen. But a lot of the times, and today, those of us who are up here, we're presiding up here together. We look very fancy, don't we? Yes, yes, yes. But we are not your leaders who lord it over you. And we will be served last because we are practicing and illustrating and acting out holy manners. We are serving one another with love. We are encouraging people to partake. We are making sure that no one is left out. We come to this table to be renewed in our spirits, that our compassion and our mercy and our kindness and our humility might flow freely. We come to be fed with the bread of new life that makes all of that happen, makes all of that possible. We come to drink of the cup of God's mercy, that indeed we might be filled with a grace that empowers us to forgive those who have trespassed against us. We come to this table because Jesus invited us, and it would be rude not to respond. He wants you here. He wants you to be renewed. He wants you to be made courageous and compassionate again. We come to this table and remember that he gathered here with his friends in a very difficult time. In that moment, he turned to fellowship, to prayer, to communion. He took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it. And he gave it to them saying, "This bread is my body broken for you. Eat of it, all of you, and remember me." And in a similar way, he took the cup and having given thanks, he poured it out for them saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sins. Drink of it, all of you, and remember me. Eat of it, all of you, for you are hungry. Drink of it, all of you, for you are thirsty." We come, for we are hungry and thirsty, and we remember in those moments our Lord's invitation. Let us pray.
On this very day, October 27, 2024, we express our most sincere and deepest gratitude to you, Father God, for making it possible for us to worship in this very special place. It is here in this very special place that we commune with our church family in remembrance of your Son, Jesus Christ. It is here in this special place that a welcome mat is always set out, and the table will be laid out with symbolic bread and wine. As we break the bread and sip the wine together, we receive blessings of grace, comfort, and spiritual peace. It is here in this very place we hear you say, "Welcome home, dear travelers. Thank you, dear God. Amen and amen." You are invited to join in and pray the prayer that Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
us prepare our hearts to come to the table by singing our communion hymn number 425. Let us break bread together.
Thank you.
Will you stand as you are comfortable and join me in singing our hymn of going forth? We are walking. Where?
In the light of God.
God! Let's do that. From this place, sing it for yourself the first time, and then sing it to your neighbor. Fellowship fund, that would be fantastic if we're going to feed you this week. Let's go have cupcakes.